is coming. Can't you see the change we need for democracy? Change is coming. Can't you see the change we need for everybody?
Change is coming. Can't you see the change we need for democracy? Change is coming. Can't you see the change we need for everybody? To save the people, we need love. To save the oceans, we need love. To save the future, we need love. To save the planet, we need love. We need love.
Yes, the change is here. I'm Rani Chor, and I'm a 16-year-old high school junior from Los Angeles, California, and I'm the graphic design director at the National Children's Campaign. This is my co-host.
Hi, I'm Madison Pina. I'm a 19-year-old Howard University student from Gilbert, Arizona, and an ambassador with the National Children's Campaign.
Happy New Year, and welcome to the first ever National Children's Inauguration. The National Children's Campaign put together this event, a youth-led virtual celebration to mark the establishment of an administration that prioritizes children and families.
Thank you so much for joining us, as we will be hosting a virtual event that highlights the issues that impact America's 74 million children and hope to excite the next generation to be involved in civic engagement and democracy. We're joined by a range of amazing guests, from youth activists and celebrities to elected officials and policy experts.
Our Youth Inauguration Committee has chosen to feature amazing speakers, including celebrities like Super Nanny, elected officials like Senator Ed Markey and Jamal Bowman, and youth activists from the ACLU and many campaigns nationwide. We want to give a special thank you to Creators for Justice and Young Entertainment activists for helping us build this amazing event. Without their creative talents, this wouldn't be possible.
Our first guest, who's not only an avid supporter of the National Children's Campaign, is also an accomplished actress and Grammy Award-nominated singer. She has starred in such projects as the Broadway production of Rent, films Notorious, Abduction, and Marvel television show Luke Cage. Please welcome Antonique Smith.
I love this song that I'm about to sing because it makes me feel hopeful. We could all use a little extra hope right now.
Here comes the sun, little darling. Here comes the sun, and I say it's all right. Little darling, it's been a long, cold, lonely winter. Little darling, it seems like years since it's been here. But here comes the sun. Here comes the sun, and I say it's all right. Little darling, smiles returning to the faces. Little darling, feels like years since it's been here. But here comes the sun, little darling. Here comes the sun, and I say it's all right. It comes. Sun, 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 here it comes. Sun, 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 here it comes. Sun, 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 here it comes. Little darling, I feel the ice is slowly melting. Little darling, it seems like years since it's been clear. But here comes the sun, little darling. Here comes the sun, and I say it's all right. Sun, 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 here it comes. Sun, 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 here it comes.
My name is Michael Michelle Harris, and I am so excited for the 2021 Biden-Harris inauguration for these following reasons. Number one, Miss Vice President-elect Miss Kamala Harris is a member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, in which my mother is too. So, I'm also a future legacy member, as you can see. But number two, quite frankly, adults, us kids need better role models. We are so, so tired as kids of seeing adults fight over every tiny little thing. And I think that the Biden-Harris team is going to mend this country so that we can have a better America. And number three, as a child of color, I am so, so inspired by the choices that the Biden-Harris team has made for their cabinet. All the diversity, seeing women and women of color and men of color, is so, so inspiring. So, thank you so much. And Biden-Harris, we can do it. Also, Miss Kamala Harris, you know, I really want to meet you. So, you know, if we can get that started, get that happening. Well, bye.
President for kids, because kids are not only some of the most vulnerable members of our nation, they are also the determiners of its future.
The 74 million children and youth in the United States are facing the existential climate crisis, a growing gun violence epidemic, worsening public health, and a worsening economy.
Our education system needs to afford the prosperity and equal opportunity that is so important to the values of this country.
Kids provide a new perspective and experiences that adults might not be aware of.
Right now, across the United States, children are living in homelessness and are being impacted by multiple issues.
In this country, kids don't have authority and kids don't have a vote, but we do have a voice.
We need a president who will listen to these struggles, including the kids, and act on what they hear.
Someone who truly considers children and teens once they're elected. Once they're designing policies that will impact not just our present, but our future.
So then kids can have a better education and then they can grow up and be smart.
The kids depend on what we do now, and we depend on the kids for our future. We need a president that looks at this pandemic as the health crisis that it is and takes it seriously so that people can go back to their lives and that children can go back to school, which cannot occur properly or safely if this pandemic is still raging. We also need a president that takes the climate crisis seriously, as we are in a climate emergency and we must act now.
These issues directly impact children, not just in the United States, but around the world. Every issue is a child issue, and it is time for our leaders to represent the interests of children. We want
a president for kids.
A president that will take care of us
and will think about our future.
We want a president for kids.
My name is Noelle Dutch, and I'm the social media director for the National Children's Campaign. Having a president for kids means having a president that's aware that the children are watching. A president that knows that most children have access to the internet and can look up videos of a country in unrest, see their president speaking on TV, or who can see the bills being passed in Congress every day. A president for kids ensures that children will have a prosperous and thriving future, that children will have a democracy that works by the time they're old enough to vote. Creating a prosperous future for children means investing in them. Currently, the proposed federal budget puts 7.3% of the budget to children. We want to increase this number by 1% to return to Obama-era spending at about 8.3% of the federal budget going to children. By investing in children, we are making them a national priority. We need a president who will make sure America's 74 million children are a national priority by investing in them, making sure they have a safe and secure democracy, and making sure they have a happy and peaceful environment to grow up in.
Hi, I'm Marianne Williams. America's greatest national resource is the American child. The greatest engine for potential peace and prosperity in the years ahead lies in the brain power of the American child. And yet, the brain power of the American child, particularly in the earliest years, that which we now know is so determinative of what that child will one day become, is almost collectively neglected compared to the kinds of resources that we give to other aspects and other sectors of our population. The truth of the matter is, we now know things about brain development among early children in early childhood that is something we didn't even know 10 years ago, 15 years ago. What we do know now is that if you want to take care of your economy the next 10 years, the best thing you can do is to take care of your 10-year-olds today. We are not faring well compared to other countries, other advanced countries. We're not doing well, really, with the American child, either educationally or on the levels of health. And these things need to be fixed. I want to talk a little bit about American history so that we can understand how it came to be that the needs of our children are so institutionally peripheralized the way they are. When the economic and political systems of the United States were devised, women basically had very little say in the public realm. And when they thought about child raising, they thought that that was just women's work. Well, women do have a voice in the public realm today. And therefore, we should be advocating for the needs of our children in a way that simply has not been done. Now, children aren't old enough to work, so they don't have any financial leverage. And they're not old enough to vote, so they're not a constituency. If you and I don't advocate for their needs, who is going to? Children don't have highly paid corporate lobbyists who are going to be visiting in congresspeople's offices, senators' offices, and in the White House every single day demanding change and demanding resources for the American child. This is why I love the National Children's Campaign and all organizations like it, which actually do that work for those who cannot do it for themselves. Every single public school in America should be a palace of culture and learning and the arts. We need to massively front end the resources of this country in the direction of America's children. If we're serious about making this country everything that it can be in the 21st century, this is what we will do. I know there's no short-term profit for huge corporations in taking better care of America's children, But what there is a profoundly more open and abundant possibilities for everything that we need to thrive as a population of people and as a democracy in the years ahead. I wish the National Children's Campaign all best wishes. When I ran for president, a pillar of my campaign was running on the notion that we need a Department of Children and Youth. I believe it as passionately today as I believed it then. And in the Biden administration, I hope that the National Children's Campaign will have a loud and powerful, passionate voice. I hope the president himself will listen carefully to what they have to say on behalf of 74 million Americans. They might be young, but they have every bit of a right to pursue happiness in their life, as does you or me. And so, let's change our thinking about America's children. Let's change the lives of American children so that America's future can be much better. Thanks.
Hi everyone, my name is Jack Kelly and I'm a youth organizer and activist, and I'm so excited to be here as part of the National Children's Inauguration, which is really an event that's meant to mark what should be an administration that champions young people for the next 4 years. And speaking about what that looks like, how can the Biden-Harris administration champion young people? There's a few ways. One way that is talked about a lot is championing youth policy. And that looks like championing climate legislation, protecting the planet that we are going to be on for the rest of our lives. That's an issue that affects young people the most because of the long-term aspect of it. Championing gun violence prevention, making sure that communities are safer. We know that young people are disproportionately affected by gun violence. Championing social justice, something that younger generations really push for. So that means passing the Equality Act, passing racial justice acts like the Justice and Policing Act. And beyond the scope of just policy actions, which is something that is essential for young people to show that the Biden-Harris administration really cares for young people, this administration can also champion direct youth involvement. And that looks like creating a presidential youth council. That's an unprecedented measure, but something we know is within the purview of the executive branch, and members of Congress have their own youth councils, so it only makes sense that the president has one as well. And that would allow for direct youth input throughout all 4 years. But Biden and Harris, so President-elect Biden and Vice President Harris, can also elect to create an Office of White House for Youth and Children, which would be so transformative and would make sure that young people are consistently championed and that their employees focusing directly on the needs of young people. I'm so fortunate to have been part of the campaign and worked on the youth team, and I know that that is something that we ran on. We ran on championing young people, and we got young voters to turn out because of that. And I'm really optimistic to see what this administration is going to do for the next 4 years to hold true to those promises on the campaign and make sure that young people are put center stage in America, and that their needs are really met, and that their policies are really met, and that we can support young people with this new administration. So thanks so much, and I'm so excited to be part of this National Children's Inauguration, because it's a reminder that young people do matter, and they're going to matter for the next 4 years with this administration. Thanks everyone, bye.
As parents and kids are juggling so many unknowns going into this new year, but one expert has been there for it all. She's a British nanny extraordinaire. She's super. I am so excited to announce Jo Frost and her alter ego, Super Nanny.
Hi there. I hope you're all keeping safe and well. Today I feel happy to be joining the National Children's Campaign for this event, making America's 74 million children a national priority. As you may already know, I'm not originally from the United States. However, as a proud Brit, our two countries have forged a friendly alliance for many decades, and as I continue to feel grateful for all the opportunities I've had to come to this country and help many of you across this entire nation, I realize America has such a global influence on the rest of the world that it is my hope the decisions that get made to better the lives of children to thrive will greatly impact and affect how children are treated across the world. My life's work is to continue being a strong voice, a positive advocate for all kids across this globe. The United States is one of the economic leaders of the world, yet their child poverty rates, infant mortality rates, and child hunger rates are amongst the highest across all industrialized nations. As a global citizen, it is important to showcase policies and practices that uplift America's children and families in the United States. Joe Biden, Kamala Harris, and the US government can do a lot to set a great example for the rest of the world on how we should cherish our children by prioritizing them. I want the next administration to make children a priority by investing in their livelihoods. For a child to feel loved and grow up to flourish, they need a warm bed, nutritious food, and a stable income for their loving families. By prioritizing children, the United States will earn its place as an international leader as it once was, and provide an example for the rest of the world. Thank you so much for tuning into this event and supporting the children.
I believe the essential question for our day is whether we can create an America where every little boy and every little girl, regardless of their zip code, regardless of the color of their skin, can thrive today and succeed tomorrow. The answer to that question is a definitive yes, if we can count on you, and if we can count on your local community, and if we can count upon the leaders of your state, and if we can count on President Biden. That's why the topic, the question, and the issues surrounding America's children are so very vital as a new administration begins to lead this nation in Washington. Please join me and so many others in encouraging President Biden to make children and families his top priority as a new day dawns in D.C. and across this land of ours.
Thank you to the National Children's Campaign for hosting this amazing National Children's Inauguration for kids and families across America. Congratulations to President Joe Biden and Madam Vice President Kamala Harris. I am really looking forward to having an administration that puts America's children and youth first. We need a president and vice president that's for the youth and will help provide a country that represents our needs and us. Our country is going through a tough time right now. I'm hoping that President Biden, Madam Vice President Harris, and Congress will come together and work hard to create a country that reflects my generation. A generation that wants all people to be treated fairly and equally, cares about climate change, and wants to end childhood hunger and homelessness. We also need more children, mental health, and wellness programs to help us deal with things that happen in our world. Two of the first things I help you work on is getting coronavirus under control so we can safely return to our classrooms, but also working on reducing gun violence so we feel safe at school, home, and while playing outside. I look forward to seeing all the amazing things President Biden and Madam Vice President Kamala Harris will do to make sure that America's youth all have a fair shot at following their dreams and living a healthy life. Thank you. Bye.
Okay. That was awesome. It's so reassuring to recognize that activism is continuing safely from home. But look, no pressure. Being in quarantine is hard on everyone, and I can definitely share in your frustration. I think we're all just a tad bit tired of Zoom fatigue at this point. But in all seriousness, leaders need to tackle COVID-19 right away. We've all seen the news.
Detroit, already facing steep economic and racial inequalities, has emerged as a coronavirus hotspot. Janine Kane is a mother of five on the city's east side.
My husband actually was laid off immediately as soon as the pandemic started because he works in a restaurant, and I was working two jobs and I was laid off from my second job.
Kane's worried whether she'll be able to keep her job as a home health care worker, the family's only remaining source of income.
We're going to still have to operate as if we have the bare minimum.
Thank you, reputable news source. Yes, American children are suffering, but that means that America itself is at risk if the next administration does not prioritize the alleviation of child poverty. COVID-19 has hurt millions of us across the nation. But see, millions of kids were already battling poverty, and now there are millions more. We need an administration that takes care of every citizen, not just those that are eligible to vote. While being stuck at home, I've been really frustrated and complaining about 6-hour-long Zoom classes, but I should be grateful that I even have access to a computer, because more than 56 million kids attended online school last spring, and out of those, 7 million lacked digital access. 7 million American children lacked digital access last spring. It is terrible that we have statistics like 73% of children in poverty are children of color. And without an organized governmental response, protests have erupted across the nation. It is a mass mobilization unlike anything that I've ever seen.
Right, and this mass mobilization is completely necessary. It has been seen through the countless protests that have occurred due to the Black Lives Matter movement. After seeing countless Black Americans die at the hands of police, we said enough. We marched for George Floyd, but also for Elijah McClain, Trayvon Martin, Sincere Pierce, AJ Crooms, and Dion Kay, who are all under the age of 25. To every Black child out there, I see you, I hear you. I know how traumatizing it is to look at the TV screen and see someone who looks like you treated unfairly. I know how awful it is to hear what has been said about Black and brown people. Whether you can empathize or sympathize, you know that children are watching. They see how we treat each other, so let's treat each other with compassion. Let's make sure every child, regardless of their complexion, is made a priority.
We are so excited for Inauguration Day and for President Biden and Vice President Harris to lead us. We want to make sure they make kids a priority.
We are asking you to remember that many kids have been separated from their families. Part of what they should be working towards is finding their families and reuniting the kids with them, and making sure they have a chance to be safe and healthy.
We also know that part of the reason people are leaving their homes to come here is because of climate change. Their homes are being destroyed, and we can do something about it. We want you to work towards ending climate change and taking care of our environment.
All youth detention and juvenile jails should be closed because there is no humane way to incarcerate children.
This is not the only issue that Black people deal with on a daily basis. We are disproportionately affected by health issues. Researchers from Emory University, Johns Hopkins University, the University of Mississippi, and Georgetown University in a recent study wrote that social conditions, structural racism, and other factors elevate risk for COVID-19 diagnoses and deaths in Black communities. Your Black friend, coworker, or neighbor has a higher risk of getting sick and not recovering. This is not only due to their ethnicity and genetic makeup, but where they live and the environmental racism that occurs. Environmental racism is a form of systemic racism where Black people are disproportionately burdened with health hazards because of where they live. Examples being near the toxic waste produced by mines, landfills, and sewage works. No one should have to live in a not only dangerous but hazardous area. Therefore, we as Americans must come together to take care of our home, our neighbors, and our environment.
Hey everybody, my name's Eric Hirschberg, and I'm so glad to see you here at the National Children's Inauguration event. Because just you being here tells me that, way younger than I did, you guys have already figured it out. You guys already get it. You get that if you care about fairness, if you care about the rules, if you care about the way we treat the world or the way we treat each other, that you gotta show up. You gotta get educated, you gotta get informed, and you've gotta make your voice heard. And that's what you're doing, and I hope you keep doing it your entire life, because we need you. You know, I've been really lucky in my life. I've had so many amazing experiences, from being a husband for the last 22 years to being a father for the last 15 years. I've got two sons who are probably around the same age as a lot of you are. And in my work life, I've always gotten to work with amazing people and great companies. I've even gotten to run a few of them, like the advertising agency Deutsch or the video game company Activision. But no matter what else I had going on in my life, I've always thought it was important to find ways to give back, to find ways to be involved in the community and to make your voice heard. And I've done that through doing free advertising campaigns for a candidate I believed in or a cause I believed in, or getting involved in organizations that were doing things that I believed in. And I think it's really important to find the time and find the ways to do that in the way that makes sense for you.
Hi, I'm Dr. Mustafa Santiago Ali. You know, our children are amazing. And that's why we need a kids president. A kids president who gets it and who's willing to make the investments to ensure that our children have a brighter future. You know, when our children are playing, they're breathing in more air, they're drinking more water, and they also eat more food pound for pound than adults do. So when that air, water, or food has pollution or toxins in it, it creates a really dangerous situation for our kids. Our children are one of our most vulnerable populations, and children of color often have additional burdens that they have to carry. You know, we have millions of kids in our country who still are uninsured, making it much more difficult for them and their families to actually be able to get to the medical services that they need. Other kids are living in unhealthy housing, which exposes them to even more toxins. And unfortunately, some of our kids are going to daycare centers and schools next to roads and highways that expose them to even more pollution. We need a kids president who understands this and is willing to do the hard work to make change happen. A lot of kids of color are dealing with exposures to significant air pollution, which can contribute to cognitive learning disabilities, to attention deficit disorders, hyperactivity, and a number of other conditions. And we also find that far too many children of color are living in cancer clusters across our country, contributing to childhood cancers. And of course, asthma. We got 7 million kids in our country who are suffering from asthma. And African American and Latinx kids are disproportionately the ones who are going to the emergency rooms and the ones who are losing their lives. We need a kids president that will focus on these issues and build real partnerships with the organizations that are out there fighting so diligently to protect our kids. And we've got kids that are dealing with exposures to significant water pollution, both in the urban and the rural context, from the drinking of well water to farm worker communities to even when you turn your tap on. And we have 1.2 million kids in our country who have been lead poisoned. We don't have to say anything more than Flint, Michigan to understand the significance of lead poisoning and how it can cause neurological problems. You know, the lowering of IQ, liver and kidney diseases, and also skin rashes and other conditions. So we need a president, a kids president, who's willing to make the commitment to end lead poisoning in our country. Together, we can make real change happen.
Hi, my name is Anajia Artist, and I am a founder and the policy director of Zero Hour. I'm so excited to be here to talk about why a president for youth and children is so important, especially with regard to climate change, which is an issue Zero Hour focuses on. Young people have made climate justice the fight of our lives, the fight of our generation, and we built the political momentum to elect Joe Biden and other candidates throughout the country, because we know that climate change is the number one issue that will face future generations if it isn't solved right now. We also know that children and youth are disproportionately impacted by issues of climate change around the world and by health issues caused by the fossil fuel industry. And so at this moment in time, we need a president, and not just Joe Biden, but an entire administration of committed people working towards climate justice, the people who need it most in this country, and for the futures of so many young people who will inherit the climate crisis if action isn't taken right now. So this is Zero Hour to Act on Climate Change. Zero Hour is so proud to be fighting alongside the National Children's Campaign and so many other organizations on behalf of climate justice and on behalf of youth and children. Thank you so much for having me.
Hi, I am Christy Truesdell, Deputy Director of the Children's Environmental Health Network. We are a national organization that has been the leading voice for children's environmental health for nearly 30 years. 2020 was a tough year for everyone, and especially for under-resourced communities and Black, Indigenous, and Latinx communities. The coronavirus pandemic and the increased severity of climate disasters, including hurricanes, flooding, and wildfires, underscored these inequities and exposed critical gaps in our nation's ability to effectively protect our most vulnerable, including our children. 1 in 4 U.S. children between ages 2 and 8 have a chronic condition, and 1 in 5 of our students have learning and attention problems. The good news is that 34% of children's health issues are the result of environmental factors that can be prevented or changed. The Children's Environmental Health Network urges the Biden-Harris administration to prioritize children by placing them at the center of decision-making. We need an administration that will prioritize children's health and equity by respecting science, dismantling racist systems, supporting disease and disability prevention and a robust public health system, and supporting universal health care and access to safe, healthy, affordable housing, schools, and childcare for all. We need an administration that will take strong, urgent, and equitable climate action with a just transition to 100% clean and renewable energy. We need an administration that will ensure that children in every zip code are breathing healthy air and have access to clean water. We need an administration that will commit to toxic-free environments and products by upholding the intent of our revamped chemical safety policy and supporting efforts that promote and move us towards a toxic-free economy. The Children's Environmental Health Network asks the Biden-Harris administration to apply a true, forward-thinking children's environmental health lens when addressing COVID-19, economic recovery, racial equity, and climate change in order to best safeguard our children's health and that of future generations.
Hey guys, I'm Sarah, and I'm the founder of the youth-led organization Climate Now. The past 4 years have been a crazy ride. We've had a president in office who not only doesn't believe in climate change, but puts his own needs above the needs of our planet. That is why I am so excited for Inauguration Day and for the Biden-Harris administration to take office. We will have a new president who, yes, believes in climate change, but who also prioritizes youth voice and youth representation in our government. It's really exciting that we are going to have a president and a VP who are representing youth and who are going to start taking actions to help our planet. But moving forward, I want to make sure that climate change doesn't just fly under the radar, that we hold these politicians and our world leaders accountable for the changes they promise to make. So as we move forward in 2021 and with this new administration, I urge all of you to continue speaking up, to share your voice, to start conversations, and hold our country accountable for helping our planet.
I need to know that my voice is not screaming for help under a flooded society, that it is being heard, not just to be heard, but to be taken seriously. I need wealthy policymakers to stop putting my future up for profit. I need to know that the beautiful scenes I am privileged to witness can be admired by my grandchildren and future generations to come. I need them to stop because we sure as hell won't. La naturaleza es belleza, entonces deja que se quede así. Because to protect her is to protect us. I just need a livable future. Is that too much to ask?
Let them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, ay. No one is disposable. Let them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, ay.
no one is disposable.
COVID and climate change ain't far from the same. People in the margins disrespected and blamed. They put oil and gas infrastructures where we play. Contaminate the land, air and the rain. Our health in a game, our lungs are inflamed. Stuck in a cage with the severe corona case. Displaced by the climate while they profit from our pain. But I don't see them treating their children the same way. Hey, they try to bury me, but don't know I'm a sea. We are seas existing, flourish, even no ID. No one is disposable, we are capable. Rooted like a vegetable and taking back the time to give it to my people. Want everything equal, no government's free throw. We know how to water the roots. Need no politician telling us how to do it. Need no politician telling us how to
let
do
them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, ay. No one is disposable. Let them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, ay.
Don't they know?
No one is disposable.
Tried to bury us, didn't know we were seeds. Frighten us, expecting us to retreat. Recede, fall back. Shut up, sit down. We rooted here and breaking ground. Concrete roses and dandelions from summertime. We fly the wind with wishes of our family riding. Rising high, carry them up to God's ears. Divine beings, we know that God hears. See the system writhing, crying, fighting for its last dying breath. It rather pillage till it's nothing left. And paradigms shift to the left. Like sharing wealth will be the kiss of death. Well, I got a news flash for you folks. Our youth are ravenous savages and they ain't gonna take no more. So kiss your billions to sleep tonight. Cause come morning time, we gon' retrieve our birthright.
Let them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, ay. No one is disposable. Let them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, no. Let them know they can't throw us away, ay. No one is disposable.
Burning bright with hope and love. Sexism, racism they throw at us.
You can throw us into dirt and darkness, but just like a plant, we grow through the soil and towards the light.
Controlling us as if we are property. Though they try to change us, we are unbreakable.
You have forgotten what happens when we unite. Together we are strongest and we will fight. We need a livable future and not just for the wealthy.
They look at us with greed-filled eyes, afraid of our strength.
The toxic pollution you dump into the air is like poison and makes us all unhealthy. I'm fighting for my sisters and brothers and Mother Earth. I'm sorry that you have forgotten her work.
It depends on our people understanding how important our voices and thoughts are. Because unlike before, we refuse to be silenced. I'm fighting for a world where people will be prioritized over profit. A world where we no longer have to fear poverty, immigration, white supremacy, racism, sexism, homophobia, and other truly ugly things in this truly beautiful world. I stand with those who continue to be systematically silenced and whose presence seems to be dismissed. For those who have been here for centuries long before us and continue to be exploited and misrepresented. I stand with the indigenous leaders who are filled with knowledge but are constantly mistakenly spoken for.
In November, we witnessed a pivotal moment in history, the 2020 election. In our This Is the Time campaign, we asked all adult allies to pledge to leave us, the children, a just and livable society. We are still asking all adults to not only continue pledging, but to live up to this pledge by putting children first. Now that we have this new administration, we have to hold them accountable and ensure they are prioritizing children by leaving us a future of equity, climate justice, liberation, and peace, one where no one is left behind. Kids matter because we will be living with the consequences of whatever choices our leaders make. Remember that children are the future.
Hi everyone, my name is Dulce, and I'm also part of Youth vs. Apocalypse. And I'm here to urge any adult out there really, and like pension funds, the school systems, and the Harris and Biden and Harris administration to prioritize students' lives and futures. In California here, there's a company that holds public schools teachers pension fund, and they're investing about $6 billion into the fossil fuel industry, which I think is super ironic because most of the students attending these public schools are the same students being affected by fossil fuels right now. A lot of these students live within a mile away of an oil and gas infrastructure, and this results in a bunch of numerous amount of health effects, one of them cancer. And not only do we need a pension fund like Callister to divest from the destruction of our planet, but we also need to incorporate more sustainability and environmental classes into the school curriculum in order to get young people to reconnect back to the land and help heal it properly. Thank you.
Hey y'all, my name is Isha Clark and I am an activist with Youth Versus Apocalypse from the Bay Area. We young people, children, the next generation want to thrive. We want to live on a planet that isn't dying. We want to live amongst neighbors that aren't suffering. We want to thrive. And though this moment is scary, we have the ability, we have the unique ability to build a new normal. We have so much work to do to ensure that everyone has their basic human necessities, like access to clean water and air and life-sustaining food and safe and adequate shelter and healthcare and the right to be who they are and love who they choose, the right to freedom, to not be held in inhumane captivity and concentration camps. We need our leaders to stand with us in this fight. We need our leaders to trust the wisdom and the guidance of the people who have been in the streets organizing, imagining, having the audacity to dream and to act for something bigger. We are the people who need to have the power and who need to be crafting this new world that we have the opportunity to build.
Hello, everyone. It's my great pleasure to be with you today for the National Children's Campaign inauguration. All across the country, young people are leading the movements that are redefining our democracy and our times. This generation of young people, your generation, is rising up, and they are demanding that we protect the planet against the greatest challenge of our time, climate change. You are the green generation. You're not going to agonize, you are going to organize. The science is conclusive. 2020 just matched 2016 as the hottest year on record. This is the challenge facing your generation. And we need to make sure that we change the course of history. And I believe that we can do that with the Green New Deal. That is why Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and I introduced the Green New Deal resolution almost 2 years ago, because it will be through an historic generational commitment to end climate change that we create the kind of democracy that works for all Americans. So what are we talking about when we talk about a Green New Deal? When we talk about a Green New Deal, we are talking about jobs and justice. When we talk about the Green New Deal, we are talking about repairing the historic oppression of frontline and vulnerable communities, which have borne the worst burdens of the fossil fuel economy. We have acted on such a scale before, and we must do it again. But it will take young people like you across the country to make it happen. And it is happening. And that's because the Green New Deal is not just a resolution, it's a revolution. It's a revolution of students and young people, and activists, and families. The question should be not if we can do it. The answer should be when we will do it. And with a President Joe Biden in the White House, the time is now. Your time is now. So thank you all for being here. Because of you, we will take the aggressive and necessary action to save our planet for future generations. Thank you all for everything you are doing and what you're going to do in order to save our planet. Thank you.
My name is Chet Monday, and I'm the Director of Youth Engagement with the March for Science. And I'm so excited to be a part of this year's National Children's Inauguration with the National Children's Campaign. Now, this year, as we celebrate a hopefully peaceful transition of power, we look towards the next presidency, the next 4 years, and what needs to be done. And I think we need to look to the children for that, because increasingly around the world, young people have stood up and shown what they are fighting for. They've brought it right to the doors of the Trump administration and many other administrations around the world who have not listened to their cries about climate change. And this year, that will hopefully change. The children need a new president, a president that is going to listen to them and also listen to science, because young people now more than ever know the importance in science and how it affects our lives. So this year, we hope for a president that will set the tone for climate action, set the tone for the entire decade, to rejoin the Paris Agreement, and to amplify the IPCC 1.5 degree report. The time is now to make great strides toward climate action, and with the voices of the youth and the children in this country, I know we'll be pushing, and I hope our next president will listen.
Hello, my name is Jenna Reed, and I'm the senior analyst at the Center for Science and Democracy at the Union of Concerned Scientists. UCS is honored to be a partner to the National Children's Campaign for this children's inauguration. At UCS, we work to advance science-based solutions to some of the world's most pressing problems so that generations to come can live in such a world. Here in the U.S., amidst threats to our democracy, we understand how crucial it is to speak truth to power and ensure the government acts with integrity and makes decisions for the people. We have watched as the prior administration sidelined and undermined science and eroded the bedrock laws that protect our health, our democratic system of government, and our ecosystems. As President-elect Biden takes office this month, UCS will be continuing to defend science and demanding that kids' health and health equity is prioritized. We partnered with organizations on our Science Rising effort to increase voter turnout in the scientist community and will continue to help foster a scientific community that fights for equity and justice. We will work to restore scientific integrity at federal agencies, ensuring that the Biden administration follows science advice on everything from the COVID-19 response and distribution of vaccines to EPA's decisions to curb air pollution, oil and gas emissions, and setting standards for environmental contaminants like PFAS and chlorpyrifos, which pose unique risks to children. We will work to restore scientific capacity at federal agencies like the EPA so that we can trust the decisions that come out about children's health and safety, and that they're rooted in the best available evidence. We are committed to following the lead of the environmental justice movement, advocating for prioritization and inclusion of frontline communities in decision-making. On this Children's Inauguration Day, UCS commits to working alongside NCC and the youth movement to advocate for science-based policies that prioritize children's health and a democracy that hears you.
Thanks. Hello, my name is Levi Dreheim, and I am 13 years old. When I was just 8 years old, I joined the Juliana versus the United States lawsuit, where other young people, like me, are trying to hold the government accountable for climate change and the harm it does. I'm excited about the incoming president and vice president, and I want a new administration's help in resolving our constitutional claims against our government. For 5 years, the Juliana plaintiffs have kept faith, bounced back from defeat, and continued fighting for climate justice. And we still haven't had our voices heard in court. Our government continues to deny our rights, and we continue to wait. I am worried about what planet Earth will look like if nothing changes. Will we be able to breathe the air? Will parts of the country, like where I live, be underwater more than it already is? How many species of plant and animals will we lose? How many people will die because of illness caused by climate change? I've lived for most of my life on a barrier island in Florida, and I've had to evacuate my family twice because of hurricanes. We didn't know if we would be able to return or if there would even be anything left. I have been harmed by red algae blooms and fish kills, and all of my co-plaintiffs have suffered directly from climate change. like wildfires in Oregon, for example. I care about the Earth and the interdependent web of existence in which we all live. I care about other young people who face uncertain and frightening future. I care about my baby sister, Juniper Rue, who loves nature as much as I do. As her big brother, I want her to have a safe and healthy planet to grow up in. I joined the Julia lawsuit because my fundamental rights are at stake. Since I am too young to vote, going to the court has been one of the few ways I can get my government to listen to me and make sure my rights are protected. Members of Congress continue to show their support of children's rights by joining the Children's Fundamental Rights and Climate Recovery Resolution, and by supporting our case with Friends of the Court briefs. I hope the incoming president shows his support of us too. President-elect Biden made promises to young people and said many times that he will do something about the climate crisis. There is something he could do right now. My hope is that he tells his attorneys and the Department of Justice to allow the Julian lawsuit to go into trial or be willing to settle settle. Actions like these would show me, my baby sister, and children across the country that he is a man of his word, and that he cares about us and future generations, and that there is hope for our planet. Thank you. Bye.
Swim so wild and you swim so free. Heaven above and the sea below, and a little white whale on the go. Baby beluga, baby beluga. Is the water warm? Is your mama home with you? So happy way down yonder where the dolphins play, where you dive and splash all day. Waves roll in and the waves roll out. See the water squirting out of your spout. Baby beluga, baby beluga, sing your little song, sing for all your friends. We like to hear you. When it's dark, you're home and you're fed. You curl up snug in your water bed. Moon is shining and the stars are out. Good night, little whale, good night. Baby beluga, baby beluga, with tomorrow's sun, now the day's begun, you'll soon be waking. Baby beluga in the deep blue sea, swim so wild and you swim so free. Heaven above and the sea below, and the little white whale on the go. Well, you know, that song was written 40 years ago, and by now there are beluga grads everywhere. Millions of beluga grads who grew up singing Baby Beluga. So for you, a new verse. Now you've grown and you're on your way, making waves in the boundless bay, with your shining light and your dreams alive for the ones you've brought this way. Grown up beluga, grown up beluga, sing a song of peace, sing a song of diversity, child honoring, social justice, climate action. We need
We need to hear you. You beluga grads and me on the go.
I cannot believe that Levi was only 8 years old when he started advocating for climate justice. And like so many kids across the nation, it starts in our communities. It starts in our communities that are within a country that we will one day inherit, where we will inherit not only American excellence, but American failures as well. That's the deal. And unfortunately, kids all across the nation have been dealt unfair cards. Take for instance that on any given day, more than 437,000 kids are in the foster care system. That's roughly the population of Cleveland, Ohio. And this disproportionately impacts those in the LGBTQ plus community. Yet only 13 states, only 13, have created policies that prohibit discrimination in the foster care system based on sexual orientation.
Hey, Madison.
Yeah?
Did you know that we are the only country in the world that hasn't ratified the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child?
Wow, I never knew that.
Today's healthy and well-educated children will be tomorrow's healthy and well-educated adults. Ratifying the Convention on the Rights of the Child sends a very clear message that our humanity is still of great importance. This administration must prevent legal discrimination that hurts the welfare of children in all systems.
Welcome, Biden-Harris administration. The Children's Advocacy Institute at the University of San Diego School of Law has been working since 1989 to improve the lives of children and youth in California and nationwide, with special emphasis on improving the child protection system and foster care systems. As you know, the estimated annual burden of child maltreatment based on substantiated cases in 2015 was $428 billion. Yet spending on children has declined by 10% in the federal budget over the last 5 years, and by 5% in child welfare specifically. At a time when the poverty rate for children is 54% higher than for adults, we have to dedicate more resources to closing that gap and keeping children and families safe, healthy, and thriving. Early in 2020, federal funding was made available to pay for high-quality legal representation of children in their dependency cases or at risk of a case. This monumental shift recognized at long last the basic due process and civil rights of children whose liberty interests are at stake in every CPS case. We hope to collaborate with the Biden-Harris administration to bolster this new allowance and codify the protection of the legal rights of children nationwide to ensure that all their voices are heard. Every day, 5 to 10 children die from child abuse or neglect, amounting to thousands of tragic and needless maltreatment fatalities. A bipartisan federal commission found that most of these deaths are preventable. We look forward to working with the Biden-Harris administration to keep children safe by demanding greater accountability by states in disclosing data on fatalities, increasing appropriations and funding to better align spending with statutory requirements, and supporting proven primary prevention strategies. Young people aging out of foster care without permanency or family experience abysmal outcomes, outcomes that create a hefty economic cost and which reflect our failure as their legal parents. We look forward to working with you to create the opportunity, health, and success for these young people that we would want for our own children. Many vulnerable youth in extended care are victimized by predatory for-profit colleges. Critical regulatory and legal efforts instituted during the Obama administration have been stripped back, and young people are at heightened risk of fraud and abuse. We look forward to working with you to make sure that post-secondary educational institutions funded by, in part by federal grants, are held accountable for their educational product and student outcomes. With a shared commitment to the infinite promise of all of our children and youth, we are confident that the next 4 years will mark tremendous progress for children's rights, protections, and for their success. Thank you.
Next, we have Alyssa Milano, who is an icon in the entertainment industry, from several successful television series like Who's the Boss and Charmed, to her roles outside the world of acting. From being an activist, an advocate, philanthropist, clothing designer, and producer, I am so excited to welcome Alyssa Milano.
Hi everyone, it's Alyssa Milano. And in the 2020 election, about 81 million people voted for Joe Biden. About 74 million people voted for Donald Trump. And about 74 million American children were not able to vote at all. And that is why it is so important that we have a president who represents the voices of those children who aren't able to use their own voice at the voting booth. In America, during the pandemic, 18 million children are currently or at risk of going hungry. I mean, can you imagine that? We are one of the richest countries in all of history, and about 1 in 4 kids are at risk of not having enough food. It's a heartbreaking number that mirrors some of what I saw in much poorer nations around the world with my work as a UNICEF ambassador. But the great news is that right now we have the opportunity to fix it. We have the chance to make a real difference in the lives of these children with a president and vice president who put children at the front of their agenda. We are at a moment of change in America. It is scary, it is hard to live through, but it's also hopeful. Keep that hope, hold on to it, and help bring it to reality. I believe in us, and I believe in you. Thank you.
You just want to make sure that all kids succeed in life, whether it's graduating high school or going on to post-secondary education.
WCA is involved in so many initiatives, whether it's GPS for kids, campaign for kids, or home visiting.
There's really no organization locally that actually has the resources and the time and energy to really make things matter for our most vulnerable children.
Everyone at WCA conveys their enthusiasm for making sure Westchester children have a bright future.
When you have advocates for kids, the kids have a chance, and WCA provides those kids with a chance.
Hi, my name is Chingun Serwin, and I am working with the National Children's Campaign because I care deeply about our youth and future in this country. I would like to start by congratulating Joe Biden and Kamala Harris on their election, and I just wanted to share 3 things I feel your administration can do for our generation. First is to invest in mental health care so every student has an opportunity for one-on-one time with a professional. This will help lower growing rates of anxiety and depression in our generation. Secondly, I would like to lower the cost of all colleges across the country and relieve student debt for low-income students. This will make college a way more viable option for all American students. And finally, being inspired by Ptanjali Rao, Time Magazine's first ever Kid of the Year. The government can invest in anti-cyberbullying software like hers, and this way, cyberbullying could be a thing of the past. Thank you for watching the National Children's Inauguration, and congratulations again to Joe Biden and Kamala Harris.
I'm the CEO of 6 Seconds, and we're proud to be supporting the National Children's Inauguration. And we stand with the efforts to put children and families and educators at the center of the administration's agenda. There are numerous issues facing kids and parents and schools and communities, from mental health to the pandemic to school safety to the natural environment. And there's a common theme among all of these challenges, which is about how human beings relate to each other and the world around us. There's a set of learnable, measurable, scientifically grounded skills that are captured in the work of social-emotional learning. And if we prioritize social and emotional learning for the adults and the children, then we're all going to develop capabilities that we need to actually solve the problems that are in front of us, come together, and do the work that needs to be done.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. So please don't take my sunshine away. So I hung my head and I cried. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. So please don't take my sunshine away. No, please don't take my sunshine away.
Hi folks, I'm Congresswoman Marie Newman, and I am so very pleased and proud to be at the National Children's Inauguration event. It is a thrilling day, and we are finally at that point where we can be very proud of our president and very proud of our vice president. They will be compassionate public servants that will actually bring us health care for all, affordable child care, affordable college education, address our climate crisis in innovative ways, and make our economy fair for everybody. Children are our future, so we have to make sure the future is ready for our children. Thank you for all that you do, and everyone please stay well and wear a mask. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Brian. I'm 16, and I'm from the great state of New York. I'm a youth organizer with the National Children's Campaign, focusing on civic engagement. I'm also on the host committee that worked on this amazing National Children's Inauguration event, and I am really proud to be addressing you all today. I find that many in our generation find government to be, well, uninteresting. It may be because of partisan bickering, or it might be because of just plain boredom in proceedings. But government is so, so interesting. And youth across America proved just that with the recent November elections. I may not be able to vote at my age, but in some states, especially swing states, you could be a poll worker, which is a boring and tiresome job for hours, but it pays pretty well for a few hundred dollars or even more. Leading up to the election, I was part of an outreach effort for an organization called the Poll Hero Project. My job was to recruit high school students, like myself, to become poll workers in their own states. But why? In a normal election year, elderly folks would go out and work at poll sites. However, as we all know, 2020 wasn't a normal year. The COVID-19 pandemic forced our senior citizens to stay home, but democracy didn't end. Students stepped up and protected it. Political affiliation didn't matter to them. Whether you were a Republican or a Democrat, what mattered was democracy and that our election would still go on safely. What is key now, especially after what has happened just days ago at the Capitol building in Washington, D.C., the seat of our nation's government, is keeping our democracy. Our democracy includes all of us, including all of you out there watching this. The opening words to our Constitution are, "We the people. We are our democracy. We uphold it. No mob of violent rioters can ever change that." And even though you can't vote at your age, you can still make a difference. And that's just as important, or even better. Write a letter or sign a petition to those who make decisions for you. Your mayor, your city council person, your representatives in Congress, or even your school principal and your board of education. Talk to your teachers and your parents or guardians about how you feel. But if you are 18 or older and at the age where you can vote, please don't take it for granted. Make sure you're registered and double check that you are. Then vote in every single election because it matters. Not just for president, but also about your local community too, where you live. Every single vote counts. Thank you so much, and let's do this.
Hello, my name is Anna Merriman Stewart, and I am a college student, activist, campaign organizer, and student journalist from Austin, Texas. The issues that are important to the youth that I work with and fight for in Texas include the expansion and protection of voting rights, menstrual and maternal health equity, including abolishing the pink tax and finding a solution to the increased levels of maternal mortality that Black women face in Texas hospitals, and electing more marginalized people, including gender nonconforming and non-binary people, women, and people of color to political offices of all kinds.
Hi, my name is Dana Graham. I'm a senior in high school as well as a youth organizer. This past election cycle, I had the privilege of working closely with two phenomenal local candidates, one for school board and one for a local mayoral race. It was through these endeavors that I really grew to understand and care about young people and youth engagement in local politics. The cool thing about local politics is that it's so easy for young people to get involved, especially because your city council, your school board, they always want to hear your voice and make sure that they are, in fact, still working for the communities which they serve.
Hi, I'm Amanda Silberling, and I'm a writer and grassroots organizer. I first got involved in activism when I was in college, and I noticed that in our Greek life system, women were exposed to unfair harassment. So, one night with a group of friends, I created a flyering campaign. All over campus, we put up flyers saying that we wouldn't sit by allowing people to be treated with anything less than respect from their peers. To my surprise, the flyers got national media attention, which helped college campuses across the country have conversations about sexism in places of learning. That experience changed my life because it taught me that anyone can be an activist. You don't need to be class president or a celebrity or anyone other than yourself to make a difference. I've remained involved in activism since then, particularly activism that supports young people. This fall, I worked with Next Gen America to mobilize young voters and achieve a record-breaking level of voter turnout in 2020. In the months leading up to the election, I spoke with thousands of people to learn about the priorities facing millennials, Gen Z, and children in the United States. For us, issues like climate change, gun control, racial justice, and affordable healthcare aren't just buzzwords. We've seen our planet change. We've marched peacefully in the streets to demand action on police brutality, and we've watched as our neighbors must choose between paying for rent or health insurance. I think we can do better. I love working alongside other young people because we have the capacity to imagine greater than what's in front of us. We advocate for people like us, but also for people different from us, because we know that real justice means that everyone's included. Even if you're not yet eligible to vote, you're never too young to get involved with groups in your area that fight for your values. No matter how old you are or where you're from, your voice matters. I'm so glad to be part of the National Children's Inauguration, and I can't wait to see what our next generation of young activists is capable of.
My name is Zoe Treyev. I'm a freshman at Duke University, and I've spent my time in advocacy fighting to break down barriers between the youth and government. Dozens of policy decisions are made every day that impact youth and students before anyone else. Calls on curriculum and school infrastructure are made in back rooms that students are either deliberately excluded from or never invited to. That needs to change. I fight for freedom of information and bringing children to the table where their lives and futures are at stake. School boards and local governments are often isolated outside of the public eye, and government education routinely fails to equip our students with adequate knowledge to let their voices be heard. Rock-solid, decades-old institutions and politicians will not change without pressure. It is up to us to press upon the dusty coals of an older age and transform them into an iridescent gem that reflects the youth of this nation. Our voices are our tools for change.
Thank you to all these great organizers. At the National Children's Campaign, we advocate for America's 74 million children and strive to inspire and empower America to make children a priority. The National Children's Campaign focuses on a wide range of issues that impact kids, such as health, education, child welfare, economic and environmental security, child immigration, and youth civic engagement. The National Children's Campaign has built a national movement that organizes mobilizations, educational campaigns, panels and roundtable discussions, lobby days, summits, strikes, marches, and media and social media campaigns to demand urgent action. If you are passionate about taking political action for youth, please visit nationalchildrenscampaign.org.
I am Mark Berman. I am the editor-in-chief for Programming Insider, which is a media destination. And I am excited to be here to talk about the National Children's Campaign. Look, we have gotten off what was a very challenging week in particular, and of course, a very challenging year. I think it is very important to keep the youth of our society informed, to educate, to offer guidance, which is exactly what this organization does. I think the youth is our future. We have to really continue to work with them. And I think the upcoming new presidential administration under the leadership of Joe Biden and Kamala Harris will offer much opportunity for this organization to continue to thrive. I congratulate the National Children's Campaign. I wish them all the best. And I'm excited about all the opportunities ahead for the youth of our society. Have a great day and good luck to everyone.
And we should all have the right to be able to have something to eat every day. It's plain and simple, right?
Red for the World for me means my faith.
We are bread for the world.
Somos pan para el mundo.
We are bread for the world.
Somos pan para el mundo.
We are bread for the world.
We are bread for the world.
Somos pan para el mundo. We are bread for the world.
Something is happening in our country right now today that needs our attention
and our activism.
I'm Kaya and I'm 11.
I'm Lily and I'm 10.
And together we started the Butterfly Effect. We wanted to stand up for immigrant families so people would realize just how many children are being held in detention centers. So we started the Butterfly Effect.
We decided to make one butterfly for each of the 15,000 immigrant children in the detention centers at the border.
Imagine what would happen if we all made butterflies as a way of standing up for kids in detention centers.
Yo, until you're free, I'll be learning about your life and rights. Looking out for what you need, working to adjust my sights. See, until you're free, I'll be stepping up physically. Putting focus on the real pick, taking responsibility. I'm not trying to live in a world that wants to remove you. I'm trying to be in a place with space to include you. We out here playing by rules that muffle the truth, which eventually becomes soundproof. Say it loud.
I'm the one standing up. I'm the one standing up. I'll be lifting you up. I'll be lifting you up. I will never slow down.
No better time than now.
No better time than now.
I'm not free until you're free. We will be louder and stronger together.
Time's up, dream. Time's up, speak. Time's up, lead. Time's up, believe.
That the time is now. That we got the power. Stand up side by side, impossible to break us down.
Time's up, dream. Time's up, speak. Time's up, lead.
That the time is now, that we got the power. Stand up side by side, impossible to break us down.
We can make a bigger voice,
yeah.
We can make it twice as loud,
yeah.
We can make a better choice,
yeah, 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 yeah,
we can be proud.
Ven conmigo y alcemos una sola voz. Que se escuche en cada esquina de este mundo. Tú decides, puedes elegir mejor. Sentir orgullo de lo que logramos juntos.
Hola.
Esta es una carta para los niños que siguen detenidos en las fronteras.
Queremos que sepan que ustedes tienen amigos en los Estados Unidos que se preocupan por ustedes.
Durante el último año, niños y familias a través del mundo han hecho más de 55,000 mariposas para asegurar que ustedes no sean olvidados.
Escogimos a las mariposas porque simbolizan la belleza de la migración y representan la esperanza, el amor y la amistad. Ahora más que nunca,
durante esta pandemia de COVID, sabemos lo importante que estén al lado de sus familias, protegidos,
sanos
y libres. Seguimos luchando por ustedes.
Don't wait. The time is now.
Call your elected officials.
Keep the conversation going. Take a stand for migrant kids.
We are still fighting for you.
Thank you, Kaya and Lily, for destigmatizing migration by showing its beauty through butterflies. Next, we're going to cover a heavy topic, one that the pandemic has actually relieved for school children across the country. Gun violence is the second leading cause of death in America's children and teens. In their lifetime, 99.85% of Americans will know a victim of gun violence. It is time for us to take action and ensure that all is done in order for children to be protected. Hear what a father, Fred Gutenberg, has to say about it.
My name is Fred Gutenberg. I'm a father of two children. My son Jesse, who's 20 years old and who's doing amazingly well. And my daughter Jamie, behind me, forever 14. Jamie was killed February 14, 2018 while in school. She was one of the many kids who unfortunately become victims of gun violence in our communities. Since Jamie's murder, I've gone on a mission to do something about gun violence in schools, to do something about our public safety, to do something to ensure our children to go to school safely so they can focus on learning, so they can focus on activities and their own social, emotional development, so that they can go to a movie theater with friends, a park with friends, a place of worship with family and friends, a mall. Unfortunately, in America right now, gun violence is a reality, but we're going to do something about it. You see, our kids deserve better than this. Our kids deserve to grow up in a world where they know their safety isn't taken for granted. Our next president and vice president know that as well. Under President Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris, not only will they renew their focus on children and education, but they're going to renew a focus on safety as well. They're going to do something about the epidemic of gun violence in our schools. They're going to do something about the reality that our kids go to school afraid today. We're going to deal with this. We're going to take this on. Our children deserve better from us. Our children should expect they're going to get better from this next administration. I look forward to working with all of you, and I look forward to the next couple of years when we start doing something about the gun violence epidemic in America. Have a good day, everybody.
Hi, guys. I'm children's author Debbie Dady, getting ready to celebrate the inauguration of our 46th U.S. president. Wow.
Did you know that six of our presidents were born in a log cabin? Hey, I live in a log cabin. Did you know that Abraham Lincoln was our tallest president at 6'4"? I'm 5'6", but James Madison was 5'4". He was our shortest president. As a former first grade teacher and school librarian, it's my hope that President Biden will encourage schools to find ways for every student to be successful with pathways for careers for everyone. My teacher friends and I are concerned with the mental health of students in this time of quarantines and pandemics. Every school needs counselors, not only for students, but for teachers and their communities. We are a country at sea without a rudder. Schools can't do it without support and funding. Luckily, our new education secretary used to be an elementary school teacher. Hooray! I'm hoping Miguel Cardona knows what my friends know. Better funding, smaller class sizes, and updated buildings with improved ventilation, as well as common sense testing, are so important. And because we've all benefited from the arts, let's not neglect their importance. How many of us needed books, music, and movies to help us survive 2020? Let's be glad our next president isn't a werewolf. That's right, Eddie said. Nobody's going to elect a guy with a long, hairy beard. Howie shook his head. Actually, there have been lots of presidents with beards. Then he started counting off names with his fingers. Abraham Lincoln, Ulysses S. Grant, Benjamin Harrison. How do you know all this stuff? Eddie asked, grabbing Howie's fingers. Research, Eddie said matter-of-factly. You should try it sometime. You could start by trying to find out if werewolves ever lived in the White House, Liza said with a whimper. Howie shook his head. I'm pretty sure that werewolves don't run for president. I hope you're right, Liza said, peering around the tree, because here comes our next president.
Thank you guys for sharing your words about education. From being on campus in Washington, D.C. to living with my family in Arizona, school looks a lot different these days. I understand how difficult learning has become from home. Still, education is very important, and here at the National Children's Campaign, we want every child to have an equal opportunity in a school system where they can reach their full potential.
Hi, my name is Ayana. I want a president who's kind and who's not racist. I want a president that is a leader.
Hi, my name is Kaylin. I would like a president that stands for racial equality and who fights for people like me.
Hello, I'm Devin Del Palacio, and I'm the chairman for the National Black Council of School Board Members and also co-founder of the National Children's Campaign. And I want a president that's going to champion public education. I want a president that's going to treat teachers with respect. I want a president that's going to invest in education to help our kids reach their full potential, because education is a civil right. And that's what we want in a president, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
1.7 million students in our country go to a school with no counselor, but those same schools do have cops. There are 14 million students in our country that go to a school that can't afford a nurse, a social worker, or a psychologist, but those same schools can afford a cop. All this, and there is no evidence whatsoever that an increased police presence actually improves school safety. In fact, it does more damage than good, and to who? Historically marginalized students like me. Black and Latino boys with disabilities make up 3% of the entire school population, yet they make up 12% of all school arrests. What's more, school districts like the one I am a part of spend upwards of $50 million each year on cops. This isn't just taxpayer money that's being used to uphold systemic racism, but it's taxpayer money that is being taken away from other valuable resources. Resources like arts education that actually proves to increase student test scores, student grades, attendance, mental health. And it creates the interdisciplinary and innovative thinking that our leaders, that our country needs. Mr. President, end legalized racism. End school police. End the school-to-prison pipeline.
Students across the country are being funneled into the school-to-prison pipeline. It disproportionately affects vulnerable minority students like students of color and students with disabilities, and the lack of mental health resources and the growing use of law enforcement in schools are to blame. There is no evidence that proves that an increased police presence in schools increases safety, and more often than not, it causes more harm than good. In schools, police officers do what they were trained to do, detain and arrest, using whatever force they deem is necessary. What they are not good at, however, is de-escalating situations. In most cases, in schools with a lack of counselors and other mental health staff, school police are called in situations where a counselor would have been much, much more effective. Instead, students are arrested. Students of color are more likely to go to a school with a law enforcement officer, therefore being more likely to be referred to said law enforcement officer and more likely to be arrested at school. Students of color are especially harmed when they have disabilities. For instance, in Rhode Island, Native American students are arrested at a rate of 126 students per 10,000, the highest in the country, and far above the national average of 22 students per 10,000. The school-to-prison pipeline needs to be ended. More school counselors and student mental health resources like psychologists and social workers are needed, and you, the Biden administration, are in charge of fulfilling this. Thank you.
My name is Zoya Uni, I'm 18, I go to Paul D. Schreiber High School in New York, and I'm asking President Biden to address the school-to-prison pipeline. We've seen the racial disparities in policing in our towns and throughout the country, and this same issue is present in our schools. Police presence in schools leads to the criminalization of students for minor infractions. Police have reported 3.5 times as many arrests in schools with police presence than in schools without. And this has a disparate impact on students of color and students with disabilities. For example, students with disabilities are 3 times as likely to be arrested than their counterparts. To remediate these issues, we need to be instituting restorative justice programs, including the increase of counselors in schools. There are 1.7 million students in schools with police and no counselors. Counselors, on the other hand, lead to not only a decrease in disciplinary incidents, but also an increase in academic engagement and achievement.
please promote this next generation of leaders by providing them with these necessary resources.
Hi, my name is Angelo Domingo, and I'm from Troy, New York. And what I want to see from the Biden administration is a change in the glaring deficiency of mental health staff and resources in public schools. Funding for police in public schools has been on the rise, while public schools face a critical shortage of counselors, nurses, psychologists, and social workers. Students nationwide are in schools with law enforcement, but no staff. There are 1.7 million students in schools with police and no counselor. And there are 14 million students in schools with police and no nurses, social workers, and/or psychologists. Even schools offering some mental health resources are still grossly understaffed. Schools in the 47 states do not meet the recommended student-to-counselor ratio. The glaring deficiency of mental health staff in schools is unexcusable, especially given the growing use of law enforcement in schools, and there must be a change.
I'm Giovanni Hernandez, and we are launching Ed Across America, the education initiative of the National Children's Campaign. Our mission is to ensure that every child has the opportunity to attend a public school system where they can reach their full potential, regardless of race, socioeconomic status, or ability. That's why I decided to launch this campaign, and I hope you will join me.
We need a president who will invest in America's children in their most crucial years. A president who recognizes that early childhood education is a foundation of our future. America needs a president who will work to provide our communities with more resources. A president who supports educators and administrators.
America needs a president who will be a champion of affordable colleges, addresses student debt, and supports America's colleges and universities. America needs a president who recognizes and works to address the racial and socioeconomic issues that damage our educational institutions.
Every issue is a child's issue, especially education. We must work to transform education across America. Thanks for helping us with this launch. Make sure you follow us at Ed Across America on Twitter and Instagram to stay in the loop with our work. Thank you.
It's a real pleasure and honor to be here. Thank you to the National Children's Campaign for allowing me to share a few words with young people across the country. Thank you so much for the work you do, and thank you for continuing to center our children and our young people. Many of you may know, I worked in education for 20 years prior to running for Congress and ultimately becoming a congressman in New York's 16th district. I started my career as an elementary school teacher before becoming a high school guidance counselor, and then I became a middle school principal, opening my own public middle school in the Northeast Bronx. So children have been the center of my work for my entire professional career. And throughout my career, I was able to pull from my own experiences as a young person, both in school and out of school, just to make sure I designed learning environments that would tap into the unlimited potential of our kids. And it's such a pleasure and honor and so exciting to now be a member of Congress and to do everything I can to center the needs of young people and how important young people are to our democracy, both in the present and for the next several generations. If we start with the needs of young people, whether it's dealing with housing or healthcare or education or poverty or immigration or criminal justice reform or environmental justice, whatever issue is important to you, if we start with the needs of children, we can design an entire political and economic system around those needs. We have to start with our children. You know, the cliche when I was growing up was children are our future. We know that to be true, but we also know that children inform us and help lead the way. We don't even have to wait until the future to leverage and learn from and work with our young people, our children, to make public policy, both at a federal, state, and local level. They are full of enthusiasm, they are full of ideas, they are full of potential, and they are full of the exact amount of naivete that we all need to believe in a world, a better world, and in a world where we're meeting the needs of everyone, and where everyone has the opportunity to meet their full potential. So it's my pleasure to be with you all. Thank you for the work that you do. I look forward to continuing to work in collaboration with you all to continue to center our kids and make sure they're at the top of the political agenda. So peace and love. Stay safe out there. We're living in some very challenging times, but together we're going to continue to do the work that we need to in order to make sure that, you know, 5, 10, 20 years from now, we're not dealing with the horrors that we're dealing with in the present. And it starts with making sure we do everything we can for our children. So thank you all. Peace and love. Please be safe, and we'll talk soon.
Today, the National Children's Inauguration is a good reminder that COVID-19 isn't a vacuum. It has exacerbated so many struggles. We call for a president who listens to all citizens. To young activists listening out there, keep the momentum of ongoing movements going. You have the power to do so.
Thank you, YEA, Young Entertainment Activists, and Creators for Justice. A large collective thank you to all of the amazing organizations who have partnered to uplift the voices of youth, such as ourselves.
Something is happening in our world. The masses of people are rising up, and wherever they are assembled today, whether they are in Johannesburg, South Africa, Nairobi, Kenya, Accra, Ghana, New York City, Atlanta, Georgia, Jackson, Mississippi, or Memphis, Tennessee, the cry is always the same. We want to be free.
Just coming. Can't you see the change we need for democracy? Change is coming. Can't you see the change we need? See?